ولا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك، أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك، أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر وأنت على كل شيء قدير. For I start, is brother Shakur with us? Brother Shakur is not here. Okay, طيب. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما، واجعل التفرق بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تدع فينا شقيا ولا محروما، اللهم آمين. Last time we started talking about بيعة العقبة الأولى, the pledge of allegiance or the covenant of loyalty. بيعة العقبة, when the a number of the Sahaba, there were 12 if you remember, they gave the covenant or they the pledge that they will support Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم on what they called in their terminology بيعة النساء. Do you remember this? The women's pledge, which means no fights. Which means we are with you, Ya Rasulullah, we will support you, but there is no agreement, there is no pledge, there is no covenant to use the physical power, and if any physical power is used, you are completely outside the whole problem, and we will not be blamed if we do not defend you physically. This is the meaning of بيعة النساء. Okay, the first year. Second year, now, today, we will be reading, and what I'm doing now, if you noticed, I'm quoting the literal narrations, because we have a very tiny details. It's good just to be connected with what used to happen. Just like a quick reminder. The seerah basically is not a narration of entertainment. We are not entertaining ourselves. Unless if you want to consider it halal entertainment, okay? Which could be, yeah, for some people, just instead of wasting his time for nothing, at least entertaining with some stories. But this is not the aim. The aim, actually, we need to understand the big context of the existence of Islam. Because seerah, as I told you, is much more bigger than sunnah. Do you remember? It's good to keep this in your mind. We have two terms or terminologies, seerah, sunnah. Sunnah basically the way of the prophets, because literally sunnah means the way, okay? Now, which means the ahkam al-shari'iyah, what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, did, acted, reacted upon, directed, agreed upon, refused. All of these things called what? Sunnah, which means this is the way of legislations, haram, halal, jaiz, you know, permissible, not permissible. This is called the sunnah. No? And the care, and let's say that the ulama, they paid attention to this much, much, much more higher than the seerah. Okay? Because it's directed to halal and haram. However, the big context of everything is the seerah. Seerah, it covers a lot of historical things, even has nothing to do directly with the revelation. Because we started the seerah to understand what used to happen in the Arabic Peninsula before the birth of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no direct halal and haram. When we understand, for example, the story of Abraha al-Ashram and the elephant and the message where they were about to attack Kaaba at the time of the pagans and the idol worshippers. This is not part of our legislations, our teachings. And we cannot take ahkam, teachings of halal and haram from this. But we understand what? The contexts, the wider context. Now, for example, when we discuss those people who used to come and said such and such, they negotiated the Prophet Muhammad, they refused such and such, they said this is not part of our teachings. But we need to understand, okay, what Prophet Muhammad was trying to do, what kind of efforts he was doing his best to discuss with different people. And by the way, before the actual happening of Bay'at al-Aqaba al-Ula wa al-Thani, Prophet Muhammad, he passed by and he exposed himself to tens and hundreds, if not thousands, because on yearly basis, from fourth year, started after the third year of secret da'wah, do you remember? Up to the 10th, 11th, 12th, and the two pledge of covenants, every year Prophet Muhammad used to do what? Keep speaking with the people. Those who come, because by the way, Arabs at that time, they used to do exactly what we do now as Hajj and Umrah. Exactly. Which means the whole year, can you, apart from the corona that we witnessed, which is completely a unique phenomena, can you find the Haram Mecca empty for a second? Not a day. No, it's always the same thing for Arabs. Because from time of Ibrahim alayhi salam, they used to come for ziyara, which Umrah means ziyara, all the time he used to skip speaking. At-Tufayl bin Amr al-Dusi, he became a Muslim through this way. He came, they asked him, don't ever speak with that crazy young man, such as the story. Then he spoke with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was doing his tawaf, for him he was doing Umrah. At-Tufayl bin Amr al-Dusi. While every time Mawsim al-Hajj, which by the way, yesterday, I think, if I'm not mistaken, we started Ashhur al-Hajj. Sah? First Dhul Qa'dah, I think yesterday. Today is the second Dhul Qa'dah. Ashhur al-Hajj, which means you do, you tuhil, which means you can have the niyyah of starting a Hajj starting from today, because some people used to travel from hundreds and thousands of miles apart from Mecca. Anyway, the idea, we need to know that just to keep, when we speak about many people, they are confused between Sirah, Sunnah, Sirah, Sunnah, Sunnah, Sirah. What is it? Sirah is the larger context, historical details, many things, which is a lot of additions from the Sunnah, which is part of the direct, you know, legislations of halal and haram. Just because I'm witnessing some new faces, in case just to be, not to be confused, okay? Now we come back to our session today. The pledge of allegiance or the covenant of loyalty, which is Bay'at al-Aqaba al-Thaniya. Now, as I told you, I'm choosing some of the, inshallah, sahih narrations from the books to read from some of the Sahaba what used to happen at that specific time in the second. قال جابر بن عبد الله الأنصاري, he says, قال ثم أتمروا جميعا فقلنا حتى متى نترك رسول الله يطرد في جبال مكة ويخاف فرحل إليه منا 70 رجلا حتى قدموا عليه في الموسم فوعدناه شعب العقبة فاجتمعنا عليه من رجل ورجلين. جابر بن عبد الله الأنصاري, very well known صحابي from the Ansar, he says, now after the first year, you remember last time what we said? The first year they were 12. They made the covenant. They left, went back. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ sent with them who? Mus'ab bin Umair. Those 12 plus Mus'ab radiallahu anhu, he kept teaching them the Quran, the Islam, and many things. Next year they came. Now Jabir, he says, we kept, now we became Muslims. خلاص, we are Muslims. We declared our Islam. And another, a new tens of new Muslim reverts or converts, they came to Islam. Still, they did not see Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but at Al-Madinah or in Yathrib. قال, we started speaking with ourselves, like when we say, hey, shame on you. Can't you see what happens with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam there? You know, between Mecca and Medina, there's, I think, 1,000 kilometers, more or less. Any people from Saudi Arabia, is it true? 1,000 or less? 400, sorry. Between Amman and Medina, 1,000, sorry. No, sorry, 400, huh? Yes. 400, it's a long distance between that time, at that time. This 400 kilometers, you say, as if they say, ثم نظرنا, ائتمروا فقلنا, حتى متى نترك رسول الله يطرد ويخوف. Till when we will keep silent, why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been kicked out from here and there, because you know when he went to At-Ta'if, what was the main reason of going to At-Ta'if? The main reason was trying to find someone to support, because he was not able to set. They are, you know, attacking him all the time, you know, narrowing every path that he was trying to take. Anyway, so حتى متى نترك, how come, why we must keep silent? We need to support him, he must be protected. He said, we decided to go and meet him, so we came with a delegation of 70 Muslims. Look now how serious it was and dangerous. Those 70, they were the Muslims among many non-Muslims from their relatives. They came next year in the Hajj time. So the people of Yathrib, they were mixed Muslims, hidden Muslims, secretly, because at that time it was very difficult. If you declare this, everyone will be against you. Politically, from security point of view, from political point of view, from media point of view, it was so dangerous. He said, فاجتمعنا عليه من رجل ورجلين في شعب العقبة. We gave him that, يا رسول الله, we want to meet you in the same place, which is the place of العقبة. And we came secretly, قال رجل ورجلين. You know, they tried to, you know, hiding themselves when the people, they went to sleep just to go and meet Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. يتابع جابر. They say, حتى توافينا till we met each other. فقلنا يا رسول الله نبايعك. We will give you the pledge. قال تبايعونني على السمع والطاعة في النشاط والكسل. I will read it in Arabic, then I will go again. قال تبايعونني على السمع والطاعة في النشاط والكسل والنفقة في العسر واليسر وعلى الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر وأن تقولوا في الله ولا تخافون في الله لومة لائم وعلى أن تنصروني فتمنعوني إذا قدمت عليكم مما تمنعون منه أنفسكم وأزواجكم وأبناءكم ولكم الجنة. قال فقمنا إليه فبايعناه. Look now. Now we have an like an upgraded, you know, conditions. The first year it was just bayat an-nisa, which means no use of physical power to protect me. Next time you understood, you know what you are about to face. It's something serious. It's not a piece of cake. This decision to hold the message of truth and to speak about the truth and to stand against some people who will try to get rid of you, it's not a piece of cake. It's not peanuts. It's not an entertainment session. You might be finding a very, very tough times from people of evil, which is the nature of clashes between Haqq and Batil from time of Adam alayhi salam up to the end of this life. Now, قال تبايعونني. You will give the pledge السمع والطاعة. You listen and you obey في النشاط والكسل. When you have this kind, you know,
energy.
Yes, this power and energy. And when you are in a very difficult times, laziness, you can't or whatever. So it's not up to your feelings. Oh, I don't feel I like it. I don't think that I would love to be in it now. No. It's like the soldier. By the way, is it acceptable from any soldier in any army now just to listen and obey the commandments whenever he wishes? Or once he decided to become a soldier? By the way, does a normal soldier have the freedom to choose when to listen and when not? I'm not discussing religion now. I'm discussing all armed, you know, troops on earth by secular, non-religious, atheist countries. Does an army have the right to say no unless if he wish? No. This is the idea, which means obedience.
Yes, sir.
And by the way, even in the private sector, business. Submit the reports, you will submit. What do we do? Is this the truth or not? You know what I'm saying? Because sometimes, يا أخي سبحان الله لا تعقدوا الناس من الدين كل شيء أوامر أوامر أوامر. نعم يا أمه. Because some people they try to portray the image of the religion as if the religion of Allah is the only thing who has restrictions or commandments that must be obeyed. Is it true? Or nearly everything in your life has the same thing? Can you work in any company and not to obey the commandments in most of the times? Maybe sometimes you have some freedom. Maybe sometimes. Even if you're in private, even if you own your own business, sometimes you have clients. Wallah. Sometimes you are forced by your clients. You will be enslaved by their wishes. I want you to finish this, or I will not sign the contract with you again. Also, immediately you will go and finish. Are you forced or not? For the sake of money, are you forced or not? Yes. So please don't let sometimes some people to keep letting you feel, because this is when you say, try to wake up your kids for the fajr. Yeah, I mean, don't push them. But for the math exam final, push them, push Abu Li Khalafu. Yes, you need to know that we have a problem in our thinking. Sheikh, hello, marhaba. Okay, you know, my daughter, she's 15, and I don't want to push her to wear the hijab, you know, because, you know, she must be convinced. لازم يكون مقتنعة. Okay. طيب سيستر كان اسك يو بليز دونت ليت هير جو تو سكول انتل شي از كونفينسد. Please don't let your kid eat any healthy food till he and she is convinced. Who will listen to me? Really, I'm asking. Who will accept this? No one. Subhanallah. Hijab till she's convinced. Math class? No, 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 no. This is a must. Attending school on time? A must. Attending the whatever class, whatever, okay? Physics, science, music, whatever. It's a must. This is your future. Subhanallah. But Allah's right is not part of my future. I'm just discussing the concept of as-sama' wa-ta'a. Because in the liberal world, secular liberal world, people, they are brainwashed indirectly about maximizing their personal ego, which means I don't like it. I don't see it. I don't feel it. I think, you should see the I is maximized to a degree. Wallahi, sometimes I feel some people, they reached or about to reach the status where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing in the Quran, أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهَهُ هَوَى. Have you not seen the one who decided to take his own personal desires as his God, which means don't like it. Who told you that we do things just when we like it? Who said so? In many times we do it because it's a duty. We do it because it's a principle. We do it because it's a must. We do it because it's not just because I think or I feel or I want. So please fix this in your minds, especially when you bring up or raise up your kids. Okay? تبايعوني على السمع والطاعة والنفقة في العسر واليسر. Your money, you will spend whether you have money or have you have some kind of difficulties, which means just when I become a multimillionaire, I will start paying the sadaqah zakah. No. Even if you are having difficulties in your financial situations, you must keep proving to yourself, not to anyone, that you believe that the money belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is the one, and I'm just this trust in my hand, and I'm supposed to use this trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. قال وعلى الأمر بالمعروف والنهي والعنك, to enjoin good and forbid evil. وأن تقولوا في الله لا تخافون في الله لومة لائم. Don't keep counting to 10. I'm not supposed to say the truth. I'm not supposed to tell the people what is right and what is wrong because they might be upset. They might not like what I say. No, this is not a true believer. Okay, be wise. Be nice. No problem with that. But don't hide the truth when the truth is needed. When, from wisdom point of view, there is a need to show the haqq. لَتُبَيِّنُنَّهُ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَكْتُمُونَ. One of the great blames against the people of the book who preceded us, that at a certain time, when Allah decided to take this kind of stats from them, because their scholars, their religious leaders, they started to pick and choose what to say and what not to say, which means not as Allah wants, but as they, their interests, you know, wants. لَتُبَيِّنُنَّهُ, it's a covenant. Those who preceded us, all of them, Allah used to take a covenant through their prophets with their followers. لَتُبَيِّنُنَّهُ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَكْتُمُونَ. I have no right to hide the truth. You must say it. Whether it goes with your satisfying interest or against it. قُلِ الْحَقَّ وَلَوْ عَلَى نَفْسِكَ. This is the truth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decide. I'm just giving you the core meaning of the covenant, which means when they say, you must do such and such, it was not a philosophy. It's not an empty talk. It has an implication. And by the way, you know Abu Jahl, how clever he was? Can you imagine how clever Abu Jahl was when he used to refuse to say أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله? Because simply, Abu Jahl used to respect himself in a human sense more than some secular Arabs in our countries. They don't care to keep saying أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله, but they are working and fighting against them 24/7. Abu Jahl realized that if he said أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله, practically means what? Practically means what? Full obedience for what Allah and His Messenger are commanding. In practice, we have a lot of Muslims, they are hypocrites. They don't care about how the level of matching between what they claim and what they do. It's so dangerous. قال الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر وأن تقولوا لا تخافون في الله لو وأن تنصروني فتمنعوني إذا قدمت عليكم. And in a case, if I came to you, which is to Yathrib, to protect me against any kind of danger which could be attacking. طب when the Prophet Muhammad says to تمنعوني وتنصروني, he was not talking about his personal thing. He is the representative of this system, of this da'wah, of this religion, which means you need to protect everything I'm bringing with me. مِمَّا تَمْنَعُونَ مِنْهُ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَزْوَاجَكُمْ وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ, which means the level of how you should be protecting me and my da'wah. In case if I came to Yathrib, it will be exactly like your readiness, your status to protect yourselves and your أنفسكم وأزواجكم وأبناءكم, which is basically an Arab or any normal person on earth, the highest level of priority of defending anything will be for yourself, your spouse, your kids. Which means if any danger is about to touch any one of these, you will be in the highest level of what? Ready. Yes, ready. Ready to fight and to lose your life. This is the nature of any man by default. فقال ولكم الجنة قال فقمنا إليه فبايعناه. طب you will be compensated if you did such and such. What is the price? What is the reward? الجنة. Look, Prophet Muhammad was not promising them with any kind of worldly benefits. He was not telling them if you did such and so, I will pay you such. No. Because you might lose your lives أصلاً. لكم الجنة. If you believe, لكم الجنة. قال فقمنا فبايعنا. So we gave the pledge. Now, يتابع جابر. جابر رضي الله عنه. Now, continues. قال توافينا فقلنا يا رسول الله نبايع فقمنا إليه فبايعنا. At that specific moment, there is another Sahabi. It's good to fix him in your minds. His name is As'ad bin Zurara. What's his name? As'ad bin Zurara. He was very still young man among the Ansar. He was thinking much more in a strategic way with a long-term thinking. All of them, they were so enthusiastic. Just they came, okay, Ya Rasulullah, خلاص, let's shake hands. As'ad bin Zurara, he stopped, he said, wait, ترحين فين? He wanted just to make sure that everyone understands exactly what are the real consequences of this covenant. Look what he did. قال, وَأَخَذَ بِيَدِهِ أَسْعَدْ بِنْ زُرَارَ وَهُوَ مِنْ أَصْغَرِهِمْ. He was from the youngest amongst them, the 70 person, 72 person. فَقَالَ رُوَيْدًا يَا أَهْلَ يَثْرِبْ. He said, wait, be calm. Don't be in a hurry and say, just خلاص, يلا, we'll give you a covenant, wait. قال, فَإِنَّا لَمْ نَضْرِبْ أَكْبَادَ الْإِبِلْ إِلَّا وَنَحْنُ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. He said, look, ضرب أكباد الإبل, this is an Arabic terminology which means we have not spent that effort of traveling for a long distance to do such anza, which means, hey, we are not wasting this time while we are not aware. No, we are aware. قال لم نضرب أكباد إلا ونحن نعلم أنه رسول الله. Be aware. We have not traveled all of this distance unless we know that he is Rasulullah. Which means it's not a surprise now for us. We know that he is Rasulullah. وَأَنَّ إِخْرَاجَهُ الْيَوْمِ مُفَارَقَةُ الْعَرَبِ كَفَّةً. Look how clever he was. He was from the youngest. He was realizing politically and from security point of view what are the real possible consequences. He said, look, you have to know that we know that he's Rasulullah. And once we declare our support for this messenger and prophet, it means by default, we are declaring our detachment from all Arabs in the Arabic Peninsula. He was so aware of how high the level of rejection will be. He realized It's, you know, just to let you feel. It's like Ukraine soldiers now, with the Ukrainian soldiers and European soldiers defending themselves from the Russians, to stand and declare, with a bit of tashbih, say, I want to declare my support for Mr. Putin and the Russian armies against Ukraine. Can you imagine what will happen to this person? I mean, everyone will be mad. Everyone will be crazy. And he might lose his life in seconds. True or false? Which means he realized how dangerous this status is. So As'ad bin Zurarah, he was aware. What does it mean to support Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Because he came with a system which will demolish the economic, sociological, financial status of people of power in the Arabic Peninsula. It's not just the philosophy. It's not just a matter of going to Kaaba and do Allahu Akbar. No, 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 no. Because this religion came with riba is haram. Zina is haram. Alcohol is haram. Practically, da'ara is haram. Prostitution is haram. Alcohol is haram. Riba is haram. What are these for? Big, big industries, which people of power in the Arab Peninsula were controlling the people. They are, in our language, the multi-billion industries. So when they say we want to live according to Islam, practically, Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, Umayyad, they realize that the industry of alcohol, in which they sell by millions, and they control the minds of people, okay? Or the slavery trade, or the prostitution trade, or the riba trade, which means we will lose power. You will lose power of enslaving the people and the power of the money and the social status, which means, no, 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 we'll not allow this. So it's not just a matter of faith, theoretically, be careful. It has a practical implication. Everyone realize that. This is the meaning of al-hukm wa lillah. Allah has the priority to decide what is good and bad, what's haram and halal. But the people of who try to enslave others, this is against their interest. They realize this. So As'ad bin Zurarah realized that. He said, you know, once you declare supporting for Muhammad, al-Arabu kaffa will yufariqukum, which means they will, mufaraqa means detaching yourself from others. You are not seeking it, but they will do it against you. They will not consider you part of them. Qala, وأنكم ونحن نعلم أنها رسول الله وأن إخراجه اليوم مفارقة العرب كافة وقتل خياركم. Look what he's expecting. قتل خياركم وأن تعضكم السيوف. Look his expression. Literally he said, the elites of you will be killed and the swords will bite you. This is a metaphorical Arabic expression. Means they will chop you to pieces. They will attack you. It's a metaphor to say, now you might lose the most important people on you and most of you will be killed. Because the mightiest power around you in Arabic Peninsula, all of them, they have one front against you. So be ready that you might lose a lot. He continues, Jabir. Sorry, As'ad bin Zurarah. قال فإما أنتم قوم تصبرون على ذلك وأجركم على الله وإما أنتم قوم تخافون من أنفسكم جبينة فبينوا ذلك فهو عذر لكم عند الله. Wow. Look, he said, look, you have two paths, two ways. Either you declare that you are ready to pay the price and to stand for the haq that you believe, or say that you can't stand for this, still you are weak, or you are coward or something, and you will not be blamed, by the way. You can be, you will be excused. Imagine, you will be excused because you did not sign the covenant yet. Because they came to bay'naka ya Rasulullah, still not yet. When the first step happened, they came enthusiastically, went, yalla ya Rasulullah, we'll shake hands with you. As'ad bin Zurarah stopped, he said, wait. Are you aware that you will face 1, 2, 3, 4? تعضكم السيوف خياركم will be killed, the elites among you, the big people, the best people will be killed, all Arabs will be against you. Are you aware of this? And you know that you believe in Muhammad and you know that he's Rasulullah. So we are not playing games and we are not kids. We are not in the entertainment session, okay? It's not a game. It's not Fortnite. Okay, I have 10 souls. Yalla, he killed me. Yalla, let's play another soul. لا حبيبي, it's not a game. They might kill you. Not because you are bad. Simply they don't want you. وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَنْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. They have nothing that they hold against them. For what you accept because they believe in Allah. Simply this is the classes between حق and باطل from day one in the existence of this life. Anyway, so As'ad bin Zurarah قال فهو عذر لكم عند الله. Look what they replied. I will read it in Arabic and give the core spirit of the meaning. قالوا أمط عنا يا أسعد فوالله لا ندع هذه البيعة أبدا ولا نسلبها أبدا. قال فقمنا إليه فبايعنا. They say أمط عنا. Say hey 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 go away. Go away. Do you think we don't realize this? Which means we know what we are about. قال أمط عنا, which means he knows that they have it, but he want to make sure not to leave one percent of you know, percentage of any possibility that any one of them might not be aware of how serious this covenant is. And they say, Amit Anna. Say, hey, go away, go away. They say, go away. Okay? We know. We know what we are about. We will do it. فَقُمْنَا إِلَيْهِ فَبَايَعْنَا. By the way, you need to understand this. What is the relevance between this and us now? What could be? Can I ask some of you? What's the relevance with that status? Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam presented Islam, they accepted, they will be the first group will be talking about the Haqq and they will be facing a lot of difficulties and problems in their face. What could be the message for you and me now? What did you understand? What could be the spirit of these incidents while I'm narrating them for you as a Muslim? I'm asking now, and I need some answers if you don't mind. Yes, brother.
There's people that abstain from speaking the truth for the same reasons. Whatever intelligence are going to be on them, the army is going to be on them.
Yeah.
They're pretty much living the exact same events.
Yes. We have some Muslims, or many Muslims, they are facing literally very similar status now. So why do we read the seerah? Why do we educate ourselves with the seerah, basically? Because it's applicable all the time. You will find a group of people at a certain time, a certain place, certain locations at a time, facing a similar, yes, similar condition, situation, difficulties. You are not alone. And by the way, pause. What did Allah tell Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam about why he is telling him the stories of the prophets? كَذَلِكَ لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ وَرَتَّلْنَاهُ تَرْتِيلًا. Look, the Quran consists of about 6,300 or 400 verses revealed in a span of 23 years of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Third of the Quran, which is about 2,100 or 2,150 verses, contains stories from the previous people. You know, 25 prophets and messengers and their people. Allah says clearly, كذلك نقص عليك من أنباء شو بداية السورة الآية. I mean the point, كذلك لنثبت به فؤادك. We are narrating, we are giving you these stories, telling you these stories to what? To let you be steadfast, to give you this kind of tranquility and power in the way of دعوة. نثبت به فؤادك. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ يَضِيقُ صَدْرُكَ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ. Look, Allah tells Prophet Muhammad clearly, we know that your chest, your heart, yourself from inside is feeling very bad, very narrow. يَضِيق صَدْرُكَ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ. Prophet Muhammad, not you and me, Prophet Muhammad is feeling bad, is having this kind of upset, you know, difficulties because what? Of what? They say, magician, sahar, kathab, a liar, mufarraq al-jama'at, troublemaker. You see, when the people around you are such and such and such and such, and you are, like now in the media, mainstream media, the last 20 years after September 11th, 24/7, the mainstream media, they are connecting Muslims with terrorism. And they are the most peaceful people on earth. The least of alcohol consuming, the least of suicide committing, the least of everything. Because the religion, yet the media has another word to say. So when you are as a Muslim, because of your beard or because of your hijab or because of your abaya or because of your thawb, all the time some people are pointing at you, look, this is such and such, such and such, such and such. وَلْقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ يَضِيقُ صَدْرُكَ. Prophet Muhammad was facing something like that. All the time, the people of Mecca, the people of Ta'if, they kicked him out. They said the very bad words against him. قال أغروا به, you know, the slaves and you know, the people to stone him. He was stoned to a degree he was bleeding literally when he was kicked out of Al-Ta'if. So we understand the importance of knowing this information. If at a certain point you feel, why should I be facing? Wait, look to your ancestors. If you think you are alone, you are not alone, number one. Two, if you think being a Muslim, you are playing a game on the internet, no. That's why, believe it or not, wallahi, believe it or not, wallahi, and Allah is my witness. You know, I told you many times that I traveled around the world in many places. And part of my field of specialization is comparative religions. And I sit with non-Muslims in many places on earth. One of the things that I always do, because always I say, see, there's someone who wants to declare Islam. Someone, please come speak with him. I said, I answer the question. Sometimes they are already ready. It's not me who pushed them to Islam. They have read them, but they have some, just some, you know, simple questions. The last 5%, خلاص, they are about to take the decision. In most of the cases, after he said, thank you, خلاص, I want to declare Islam. I could please think very well. He said, Sheikh, I want to become a Muslim. I said, I don't encourage you now. Go and think about what I have told you. He said, what? The people around me, they say, Sheikh, are you crazy? You want to become a Muslim? Yalla, بسرعة, Allahu Akbar, yalla. Say, wait, wait, Habibi, it's not a joke. It's a, are you aware? I have told you that you have to do what? 2, 3, 4. You need to stop doing 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 10. You will be, yes, alhamdulillah, complete, a clean record. All of your sins will be rewards. However, you are not allowed to do such and such. You have to stop doing such and such, commitment. Islam is not just a wishful thinking. Okay, it means y'all nice. I don't become a Muslim. Nice, yalla, let's enjoy. Okay, Habibi, practically, there's a price will be paid. Have to pray. You want to pray sometimes? I would love to sleep. You need to wake up for Fajr. You need to stop looking at porno. You must be polite with your parents. Habibi, stop. My mother and my father, they are the worst people on earth. Hatta. You must be polite to them. No. You need to be prepared. Are you ready to be polite? Once you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, even if your father and your mother, they are the worst two couples in the galaxy, not on planet Earth, you have no right to be tough with them. Are you ready? I said, no, I want to think. Oh, please go and think and come. We are not playing games here. And by the way, Islam is not my personal property. And it's not my own product. I'm not selling your product. I'm just showing you the gift of Allah. I'm just, you know, a mean of communication. It's not. So please, are you sure? Say, yes, I know. Thank you very much. I want to declare. Khalas. But it's not just, yalla bsura, say Allahu Akbar. Next day he discovers that he has commitments. He is going to say, no. I don't want. No. He said, we don't do it. At least this is my way. Because you need to know, once you say, you say it, you declare it. We Muslims, you are declaring. And by the way, unless in a very, very, very rare situations, you have no right to hide your Islam. And by the way, you can't hide it, Islam. Especially the sisters, Jazahum Allahu Khairan. Wallahi, you know, by the way, the most powerful, moving, living da'wah for Islam is the hijab. Because, I mean, the Muslimah, by the hijab, if she's wearing the hijab for the sake of Allah, once she's out, she's a da'i, whether she wanted or not. Not necessarily us males, because most of us, not easily you can tell that you are Muslims. But a sister, it's impossible not to know that she's a Muslimah. So she's a da'i. So enjoy being a da'i without saying a word. By the way, without uttering a single word, you are a da'iyah. Because modesty, moving, a moving example of modesty and purity. You can't hide it. How can you hide it? Imagine someone will say, I'm a Muslim, I'm living in a Muslim country, but I asked my wife and my daughters not to wear the hijab so that not to show off. Now, Habibi, excuse me, what? You know, not to commit riya. I can't go to the masjid because I don't want to show off. Now, Habibi, you can't. By the way, you can't. I don't want to go to the Hajj because I don't want anyone to see me so as not to show off. Naam, Habibi. Habibi. You have another religion that has nothing to do with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No, it be read to fix. No, no. Islam cannot be hidden. Actually, it was designed by Allah to be seen because of the system of people on earth. Should be. So anyway, I mean, you need to be ready. Okay, that's good, Sheikh, that you told us. Maybe we'll change my mind. Do you want to change your mind? But look, what is the reward for that? Walakum al-Jannah. Walakum al-Jannah. We pay an amazing effort just to have, at the end of a month, the salary. Or we pay a lot of efforts all of our life, and we have this kind of special funds, special installments on for 30 years to have what? Retirement plan. True or false? What is the best of what we have in a retirement plan? Good, decent, nice place of living. Good food. Living alone. Till I die. No kids. No families. Okay? Maybe a good health condition. But at the end I will die. Allahu a'lam what will happen after that. What kind of efforts someone for a retirement plan could be paying? You tell me. Those who are born in this country. What is the average, by the way, since when Canadian people start paying for retirement plan, in average? Start paying. Do you have an idea?
18.
Huh?
18.
Start from 18. Retirement plan. I don't have an idea, I'm asking. Literally, I'm asking. Please, if you have an idea, tell me. I heard once from 30s they start, but I'm not sure. I don't have a solid evidence. So, yes, brother?
Things like when they start career jobs, so when they finish university and actually get a job.
Wow.
And
then
the career set up, and that's when they start planning.
When they start having a job.
When they start working, yes. I have a career job, that's in the way.
Which could be 20 plus.
Yeah.
They pay installments for retirement plan, which could start re-benefiting around the age of 50 plus or 60 plus, huh? Which means, this is my point now, the one of us could be paying money for 35 years on a hope of enjoying a decent style of living, which not necessarily is able to witness it because he might pass away. You know what I'm doing now? Because when I say, walakum al-jannah, some people they say, ya sheikh al-jannah bidna al-an, we need now to enjoy. If that's the case, you tell me why you pay 4 years or another extra 6 years for your MA degree or another 4 years, the total is 10 years to have your PhD on the hope of enjoying a good academic status, having a good assistant professor 10 years later. Why not to have it now? It's completely against the law of our existence. You can't have it now. 4 years of your BA on a hope to graduate with a possibility to find a job, not necessarily. So do we apply this in our secular materialistic mentality or not? Why we have a problem when they say Allah is promising you with the Jannah? Everyone is doing that with you. Why you have a problem just when Allah says the Jannah? The people, they promise you with the Jannah of the job without any guarantee of fulfilling their promise. True or false? I'm just paying the attention so as not to let the satanic way of thinking say, hey, on the basis of what? Hamimi, you are applying this on daily basis 24/7. We do, literally. طيب. قال فبينوا ذلك فهو عذر لكم, which means show if you can't do it, if you feel you are weak, you can declare it, say it. You will not be blamed. You will be excused, by the way. This is As'ad bin Zurara telling the Ansar. قالوا أمط عنا والله لا ندع البيعة ولا نسلبها قال فقمنا إليه فبايعنا فأخذ علينا وشرط وعطي ويعطينا على ذلك الجنة. So we discussed, we say, I want to do such and such, you do such and such, such and such, okay, shake hands, covenant, خلاص. Practically, I will stop now inshallah. We have a lot of details about this specific. I will go in depth of what happened, of discussions and tiny details and the benefits of this bay'ah, inshallah. But Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. The most important message that I want to conclude. Please keep in your mind all the time that as a Muslim means submission. Submission to what? Commitments. Fi iltizamat. To the will of your Lord. The definition in general we say, a Muslim means the one who has decided to submit himself to the will of his Lord. The will of his Lord means do and don't. In a very simple word. Do and don't. What is the will of your Lord? Do and don't. باختصار. It's not just a philosophical attitude in your heart. No. Or otherwise, I said it maybe 100 times, I will repeat it again. The concept of Tawheed, please fix it in your mind. Concept of Tawheed, monotheism, is not just to believe that Allah is one. This is a big mistake. Because many non-believers, they believe that Allah is one. And it's not just to believe that Allah does exist. Because many non-believers, okay, deism basically, deists, which is part of non-believers, al-rububiyun, they believe that Allah does exist and He's the Khaliq and He's the Creator. But they are non-believers in our terminology. It's not just to believe that Allah does exist, and it's not just believe that Allah is the Creator, and it's not just to believe that Allah is one. No, to believe that this only Creator and this God who created everything, He is the only one who deserves to be worshipped and obeyed in His commandments. Otherwise, you will share a lot of non-believers their faith. And His final will basically is embodied for us by the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Quran. So not following His final will, i.e. Quran and Sunnah, practically I'm not a believer. So it's not just to believe that Allah is one. Obedience. The core point is obedience. And I told you many times, and by the way, this is not a clever conclusion from me. This is as the Quran says, وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ يَقُولُونَ الله. If you قال وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَسَخَّرَ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ يَقُولُونَ الله. If you ask them, O Muhammad, who created لَمَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ heavens and earth, they would say Allah. They are admitting that. وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ خَلَقَ وَسَخَّرَ الشَّمْسَ. He's subjugating everything in the universe as well. Control. It's not just because some philosophers they believe that Allah does exist, but He has nothing to do with the people. They are called deists or deism, al-rububiyun. They believe in the existence of Allah and they believe that Allah created everything, but He did not send messengers. Which means when you ask them, but يعني, what's the purpose? خلاص, He just created. He wanted to enjoy creating. Then He detached Himself and it's up to us to decide what to do and how to do it. حسبي الله ونعم الوكيل. طب, يعني, part of the wisdom. Do you do it if you wear him? God forbid, for the sake of Allah. No, because I will communicate with my God. No, he did not send prophets. This is an indirect way to detach themselves from any commitments. And by the way, many youth whom I met in my life, the previous 25 years at the university, I met them supposedly atheists. I was asked to help them as what? Atheists, which means they deny the existence of God. I discovered after discussion that they know nothing about atheism. They themselves, they don't know what atheism is. Simply, they want just to get rid of Islamic teachings. They don't want anyone to tell them halal and haram. They don't want anyone to restrict them to yajuz and la yajuz, permissible, not, no. They want just to say, hey, I don't believe in Allah, I don't believe in anything, so just please shut up your mouth, don't interfere in my business. I want just to enjoy my desires. And the core reason for their claim that they are atheists simply to get rid of commitments. Wallahi, I met those people, tens of them. I had hours of discussions and I discovered this in reality. Anyway, I read about that. It's part of my research as well. But I'm talking about my personal experience. So the core point of our existence is commitment. It's not just the knowledge. It's not just understanding. Not awareness, not knowledge, not understanding, not being convinced, to commit yourself accordingly with what you have discovered. This is Islam. And by the way, many scientists, they are aware that Islam is truth. But they refuse to submit. So they are not Muslims and they are not terminologically believers. But they believe in Allah. As a terminology, you need to submit. This is the practical way of having, it's like having the visa. You need to stamp of the visa to come, not just to believe that you deserve the visa to come to X country. Wallahu alam. Anyway, I will stop now, inshallah, bi'idhnillah. Tomorrow. Yes. Saddaqahu al-amal. Jazakallah khair. Barakallah fi. Thank you very much. Jazakallah khair. Khitamuha misk, inshallah. Jazakallah khair, Abu Abdullah. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى رحمه برحمته أن يغفر لنا ويتجاوز عنا جزاكم الله خير. Tomorrow, in case if you are interested, every Tuesday, tomorrow between Maghrib and Isha, we have that تفسير session إن شاء الله. صلى الله على سيدنا محمد. السلام عليكم.